Good morning. I call this planning session meeting for the Forest Preserve District of DuPage County on March 9th, 2021 to order. If you could please rise and join Marsha Murphy for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States, States of America, to the Republic, for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible.
With liberty
and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Commissioner Harris.
Here.
President Hebriard.
Here.
Commissioners Al Murphy.
Present.
Marsha Murphy.
Here.
O'Meara.
Here.
Painter?
Here.
Tyson Dunn?
Here.
All present.
Thank you. The Forest Preserve District of DuPage County was voted into existence over 100 years ago in 1950. Looking back, we are able to see a unique breakdown of the votes from that historic time. The men of DuPage voted narrowly to oppose the formation of the Forest Preserve District, with only 49% supporting it. However, the women of DuPage voted overwhelmingly to support the measure, with a whopping 88% in favor. Thanks to female foresight, the Forest Preserve District became the largest landholder in the county, the leader in flora and fauna, and the agency connecting our residents to nature. And I am extremely grateful for that. DuPage benefited from the vision of women only because Illinois was the first state east of the Mississippi to grant voting rights to women in 1913. Women such as Elizabeth Boynton Harbert, Frances E. Willard, Jane Addams, Ida B. Wells, Catherine McCullough, and Grace Wilbur Trout were the driving force behind this. And they continued to push, ensuring that Illinois was the leader in the suffrage movement. In 1919, their hard work led to Illinois becoming the first state to pass the 19th Amendment, granting women full voting rights. Today, this organization celebrates a female majority with four women out of a seven-member board, only the second time we've had a female majority on the Forest Preserve Commission. To honor our fabulous female staff, we recently released a blog entitled Meet Some of the Wonder Women of the Forest Preserve District 2021. It can be found on our social media pages and, of course, at dupageforest.org. With that, I'd like to wish everyone a happy Women's History Month, and I hope you had a great International Women's History Day, Women's Day yesterday. And Judy, is my understanding that we do not have any public comment this morning?
There are none this morning, Mr. President.
Thank you. The first item on our regular agenda, R1, is a recommendation to authorize a resolution requesting repayment to the district for all unanticipated IMRF contributions owed for Commissioner Emeritus Tim Whalen. And that is my item. We had an informational about this from Jack Elster. During that informational, we had some good discussion. One of the things that came up was there was a board vote back in 2017 to direct staff to get rid of pensions. At that time, doing nothing was able to accomplish that feat. However, the Supreme Court of Illinois has struck that down and has enabled people to go back and get their pension. Since this was unanticipated and he took a vote to vote no for the pensions, I think this $29,000 would be an appropriate step to have him reimburse the district and taxpayers. And with that, I'll open it up for any comments or questions. Okay. Seeing none, we will move on to R2, which is a related item. This is a recommendation to authorize the termination of participation by elected officials in the IMRF. And again, this is my item. This goes back to the narrative for the first item. Board in 2017 here at the Forest Preserve did vote to try to get rid of the pensions, who have not been collecting since 2017. However, with the Supreme Court ruling, we do need to decertify. I'd like to make clear that I focused on a couple things with this. One, this board is not diminished in any way. The work being done by the board members is not diminished in any way. I think it's a couple different things. There's a 1,000-hour requirement for IMRF to get a pension. I don't know if this position requires that. I'm happy to say that each commissioner I've worked with on this board currently is giving the full attention needed to the agenda, to their elected officials, and to their constituents. So I'm very proud of that. And I think that is a great example of public service. And I think that is something that we will do continue to do moving forward. But this is a way to also be very fiscally responsible and to move forward in a way saying that as our staff, we want to protect that IMRF pension. We want to make sure it's really strong. And as elected officials, we do not need that for ourselves. So with that, I will open it up to any discussion or questions.
I just want to say over the years, I don't think anything has gotten under the skin of the taxpayer more than the idea of people having positions like this, asking for pensions and expecting a pension. And I think when you think of the school boards and village boards and city councils where I don't think anybody gets paid even, it's just for public service. And I must say also, I've enjoyed the last 3 months on this board, and I think there's a lot of good work we do. So I appreciate President Hebriard's comments that, yeah, this is a strong board, and we're doing good work. But I don't think we need pensions for given the nature of what we do. So I would rather reserve that for the hardworking staff who spend 40 hours plus a week doing good stuff for us. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you for the comment. Further discussion or comments at this time? Okay, moving forward on our regular agenda today, we have R3, which is a recommendation to authorize a professional services contract between the Forest Reserve and Environmental System Research Institute Incorporated, ESRI, for services related to upgrading and the migration of GIS data and services. And we welcome Joe Potenza for that item.
Good morning, Mr. President, Board of Commissioners, Joe Potenza, Information Technology. As the president mentioned, agenda item R3 is the recommendation to authorize the execution of a professional services contract between the Forest Reserve District of DuPage County and Environmental System Research Incorporated, ESRI, for services related to upgrading and the migration of GIS data and services. As the technology landscape continues to evolve, we seek opportunities to enhance the district's service offerings, streamline our operations, and provide computing resources that are modern, highly accessible, intuitive, and secure. The district's GIS application and services are an enterprise resource, meaning they're widely used and heavily consumed across our organization. And this is critical for staff to perform their day-to-day operations. These resources are shared with governmental agencies through shared service initiatives, DuPage County is an example, and consumed by the public as well. With some recent software releases from ESRI, the district's current software environment does not provide an opportunity for upgrading, which puts us at risk for future obsolescence and prevents staff from taking advantage of technological enhancements as they're available. This agreement in front of you allows for three key items. The first item is upgrading the GIS software. The second item allows us to move these services to Microsoft's latest server and database operating systems to take advantage of those features and functionalities. The third item is to migrate the service to Microsoft Azure, taking advantage of their robust cloud computing platform. The quote you have in front of you is broken down into two components. There's a jumpstart section, which allows for 4 days of working with an ESRI consultant on developing and implementing a configuration plan, providing installation and configuration assistance, along with the knowledge transfer of the new GIS enterprise technology. Provides a detailed review and training of ArcGIS Enterprise Administration, creating and connecting to enterprise geo databases, creating and working with Arc services, and the final configuration of ArcGIS for our organization. The second component is the retainer, which allows us 20 hours of remote consulting to assist with advanced topics and advanced configurations. The total amount for both of these items in this quote is $25,500. This professional services agreement is proprietary to Esri as their services supports their software. I wanted to take a moment to display a couple of slides on the department utilization of GIS and some of our application uses as well. Tony, if you wouldn't mind, please, could you put up a couple, put up this presentation? Thank you. So this slide provides, as I mentioned earlier, GIS is a highly consumed enterprise application. And as you could see, the majority of our departments within the organization consume and utilize GIS, natural resources, community services, site operations, planning, land preservation, facilities management, information technology, community relations, human resources, golf, the executive office, and law enforcement all utilize GIS. Next slide, please, Tony. So what you have in front of you is just some examples of the programs that we use for GIS in the district. I'll mention some of them for you. District Lakes, the Deer Management Program, the Tree Inventory Programs, the Species Location, the Evacuation Maps, the Encroachment Program we use for law enforcement, Trails Bench and Planning, and the GIS Sign Collection. As you can see, these are just some examples of the utilization of applications we use for GIS in the district. With that being said, I wanted to provide this opportunity just to share this information with the board to reconfirm just the usage of GIS within the organization. And with that, I'll answer any questions that you may have. Thank you, Tony.
Thank you for the presentation, Joe. I know I've been using ArcMap here for over 15 years, and it's a great tool for staff. Really helps with boundary incidents and also with concerns. And I know you said our public has been brought into that portal, so that's fantastic. So I'm excited to see this as a more mobile option moving forward. Commissioner Garris?
Yes, I'm really impressed with how we use GIS. I knew we were a data-driven organization, but to see that chart of all the things we use it for is impressive. So. And I understand the need to go to a more secure platform, especially with what's in the news with Microsoft lately.
Yeah.
But is there any specific enhancements that this new software will have? I might have missed something. Any examples of things we can do better with it?
What this is allowing for is things are becoming more and more web-enabled. Right now, our current GIS is more desktop-driven. Esri, like all services, is moving more to a more web-delivered option. So with this migration, we're able to take advantage of those capabilities, which will increase staff's accessibility to those resources as well. More intuitive interface as well, too.
Good.
Thank you. Further discussion or questions? Great. We look forward to hearing more next week.
Great. Thank you.
The next item on our regular agenda, R4, is a recommendation to authorize the execution of a contract between the Forest Preserve District and H.W. Lochner Incorporated for professional services for a bridge evaluation and replacement study of the Blackwell Forest Preserve, Senecal. And I believe we have Jason Berger with us and Bill Lynch.
Good morning, President Hebriard, Commissioners, Executive Director Stevenson, and all others that are in attendance. I am Jason Berger, the Facilities Manager for the district. First, I'd like to welcome all the new board members on behalf of Facilities Management, as this is our first agenda item that we've brought forth with you on board. Today, we're presenting the recommendation of the bridge study for the property referred to as the Senecal at the Blackwell Forest Preserve. This property is just northwest of the intersection of Butterfield and Batavia Roads in Warrenville. Before I turn it over to Bill Lynch, who's the lead staff that'll be working with this assessment with Lochner and also runs our bridge inspection program, do want to make some clarifications in the board summary. There was mention of a date of 1955 with the AT&T retreat campus. There was some confusion on some of those dates, and I didn't want to not give you some more insight to the history of that property. So I'm going to give you a brief overview. It was basically the Senecal property originally was purchased by Illinois Bell, and it was to build a retreat for the phone operators in 1913. And it was an opportunity to pay phone operators, those women who were extremely stressed with those jobs back in the day. And then in 1939, Our Lady of the Senecal converted this property into a retreat for Catholic nuns. And it remained as such until the district acquired it. Over several years, there were additions, along with two houses and other structures that were added to the property. In 2008, the district acquired the property, taking possession at the beginning of 2009. All the infrastructure except for this bridge were removed from the landscape, with the exception, obviously, of the bridge. It was basically left in place in order to enhance the trail system, allow access from Batavia Road all the way into the Blackwell proper. And there was also a secondary access on the opposite side of the peninsula, which spans over Spring Brook. And just so that you know, as this assessment goes forward, there's also the phase three of the Spring Brook project that will be coming through that area. And there is a bridge crossing there that's also going to be evaluated and may also influence some of the decisions of the assessment outcomes that we have on the Senecal Bridge. And also the exact age of the bridge is, we're not exactly sure. We have not been able to pinpoint that, or if it's actually the original construction design. It has likely been located in that same location throughout at least the Our Lady of the Senecal's ownership. The Senecal Bridge is aged beyond what is a state of general maintenance, as more of the structural components are now showing fatigue and are beginning to fail. The goal of the assessment is to basically evaluate all options as it relates to the impacts to our community, as well as the financial short and long-term costs of the ownership of the structure. I'm going to now turn it over to Bill Lynch, who's going to provide a little more insight into the technical details of the options that are being explored in the assessment, the bridge constructions, the current conditions as it relates to our bridge inspection program, and why we're basically here today to recommend a contract for the assessment of the structure. So, Bill, if you'd like to take it.
Very good. Thank you, Jason. Good morning, President Hebriard, commissioners, and everyone else in attendance. Again, my name is Bill Lynch. I'm the Assistant Facilities Manager here at the district, and I'm here to recommend the district move forward with a contract with H.W. Lochner for professional services to evaluate and develop a replacement study for the Senecal Bridge at Blackwell Forest Preserve. So, building on what Jason has already outlined for you, and just taking a step back, just to understand our overall bridge program here at the district. The district has approximately 100 bridges. Those bridges are evaluated on a cyclical basis. That time frame has been developed over the last 7 years. We started this program in 2014 with some identified maintenance that seemed to be a structure that seemed to be well beyond our maintenance capability. So we're a maintenance team here in facilities. So we really can handle the routine, but sometimes things become broader or more dynamic than our in-house capabilities. And one of the things that we discovered when we started looking at the bridges, we had a number of structures that were reaching that point. So, in doing our research and talking with some outside consultants, we recognized the need to develop a maintenance program. And so this bridge is one of about five in the district that is falling into a point of what we would consider beyond our ability to make improvements or keep operationally at the highest level. So there is a scale. It ranges from 0 to 100. There's really no structures that are at 0, and there's really none that are at 100. They tend to be in between about 10 and 90. For us, our average across the whole district is 77, which we're really proud of. That basically means that all of our structures are sufficient. They're meeting the need. They're in good operational state. However, we do have a number of structures that, just for a point of comparison, we have three zones. So once a structure falls below 70, we start looking at it and saying, what kind of maintenance things do we, improvements or modifications or treatments do we need to take with the structure? And then when the bridge falls below 50, we say, all right, now it's become deficient. And what do we need to do to make that structure last? Is there anything that we can do to make it last? And so this bridge is currently rated at a 55. It hasn't quite fallen below the 50, but it's at 55 for a very specific reason, because in a previous evaluation in 2016, we did a load rating analysis, and that analysis tells us what's the capacity of the structure. The structure was previously designed to be at a 25 ton capacity. When we did the load rating analysis, we identified that the structure was no longer at that rating capacity. It had fallen significantly below, and we now have it rated at 5 tons. And that's the only reason the structure is at a 55, because it can handle our smaller vehicular traffic, some of our pickups and pedestrian traffic, but it really can't handle some of our larger vehicles here at the district. So just from a safety perspective and to try and keep the bridge on the landscape as long as possible and limit further deterioration, we've limited the size of the vehicles that can cross the structure. So that brings us to where we're at now. After reviewing the structure for the past 4 or 5 years, we look at this structure every year because it's at that 50-year mark. We've made repairs, and we're just running out of good material to make our repairs too. So we go and replace a deck board, there's nothing for it to fasten to. When we go and replace a railing section, there's really no good sound material for us to make an attachment to. So the character of the bridge has suffered as a result of us having to use metal plates or plywood to keep it in service. So saying all of that to say, we're now presented with the need to have an outside expert provide us with a recommendation. And so we looked at it and said, we want to rehabilitate this structure. Do we want to replace this structure, or do we want to remove this structure? Those three options are really the baseline for how we would move forward and looking at options for this, and what's the cost and what's the impact to our users, what's the impact to the district. Those are all the factors that we're asking the engineer to take a look at and put into consideration, and then provide us with a cost to make the repairs, to make a replacement, or to remove the structure. So one of the key components of the rehabilitation option would be to return the structure to either a 10 or 20 ton capacity, which would improve our ability to move vehicles across the structure. The same thing would be true for the replacement option. We'd be improving it to make it, bring it back to where it was historically. So that's really the focus of this assessment. I think at this time, without getting too much more into the weeds on bridges, turn it over to you guys for questions.
Thank you, Jason and Bill. Commissioner Marsha Murphy?
Yes, I do have a question. I want to say thank you for the presentation, and I'm 100% behind this program. I'm glad that we're maintaining our bridges, and we have the program to keep monitoring them, to keep them safe for everybody. So thank you for a great presentation.
Thank you.
And I actually see Commissioner Garris.
Yeah, thank. Was looking. It looks like a good interconnection to Warrenville, so I presume that a lot of hikers go through there. And I'm very much in favor of bridges that help us interconnect the communities with the trail system. And I'm also wondering about the vehicles. I don't know how important it is for us to have large vehicles go through there, but it occurs to me that emergency vehicles might need to go through if somebody's on the trail and needs, first responders to arrive. They tend to have very large, heavy vehicles, and I would hate to see them be forced to stop at a bridge and can't reach somebody directly. Is that part of the consideration?
So this location, as Jason had mentioned, basically brings you from Batavia Road over the West Branch, and then continues on over Springbrook Creek and into kind of that southwest corner of Blackwell, where we have the Urban Stream Research Center. So this the trail section could be accessed from both the east and the west. So if somebody went down somewhere, the only section where a vehicle currently could not basically access them would be everything east of the structure. The crossing that's at Springbrook is too small for a vehicle to cross. I don't know what NR's plan is for that structure. To your point, yeah, it would be beneficial if we did have the ability to bring a emergency vehicle all the way back to every portion of this trail system. So that would be a consideration for options one and two. Obviously, if the structure was to go away, we would then be relying on that Springbrook section to tie into the loop that is on the island or peninsula that Jason referenced. So,
yeah, in addition, there are some utility infrastructure that also runs through that peninsula. In fact, the Urban Stream Research Center, it's Nicor Gas, it's water main, everything is actually fed from Batavia Road. So aside from the emergency, there's also some utility access consideration. So as we mentioned with the Spring Brook project, when we start working more with NR, we'll be looking at all those solutions because one way or another, we need to get some maintenance capacity and then potentially the emergency. So definitely will be discussed.
And one last question, is this bridge considered to be of historic value to the community? And it has a long history and it's got unique design, architectural features that I've never seen before. So,
yeah, it obviously in terms of like our cultural resource policy, it's obviously older than 50 years. So it would be at least having to be evaluated. What we typically would do with any demolition or any major reconstruction is you may have heard on some of the other bridges like at Hidden Lake, we would likely have to start with an HRS, a historic resource survey, and do a little bit more in-depth history on it before we make any significant modifications. Mm-hmm. But obviously with the history of Illinois Bell, Our Lady of the Cenacle, there is history there. It's recognized by the county and also the Warrenville community. So we definitely intend to consider that as we move forward.
Great. Thank you, gentlemen. Great presentation.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, just to further those comments, I parked at the post office and took a hike over to it on Sunday, and it is a beautiful structure. And so I know we're going to look at every option. I think that's important, but I'm going to certainly hold out hope that the rehabilitation is a good option. So thanks again for the presentation, and we look forward to hearing from you next week.
Very good.
Thank you.
R5 is a recommendation to authorize execution of a professional service task order contract between the Forest Preserve and Webster, McGrath, and Allbirth for district-wide surveying. We have Kevin Horsfall.
Good morning, President Hebriard, Board of Commissioners, Executive Director Stevenson. I'm Kevin Horsfall, Manager of Planning. Item R5 involves a professional service contract between the Forest Preserve District of DuPage County and Webster, McGrath, Allbirth for district-wide surveying. Surveying here does not refer to public opinion or input surveys, rather data collection that allows staff to plan, design, develop and permit capital improvement or master plan projects. Land surveying tasks are often small in scope, repetitive, and can cost a few thousand dollars each. And this work includes providing stamped and sealed topographic surveys, creation of plats, easements, legal descriptions, and verification of property boundaries. The task order contract allows us to complete these tasks in a consistent and timely manner. About every 3 years, we solicit a proposal from a qualified professional land surveyor to perform this work. In anticipation of the extensive list of upcoming capital improvement and master plan certified projects, staff has requested that current task order contract to not exceed the amount of $40,000, which would allow for up to a dozen different tasks to be accomplished over the next 3 to 5 years. Tasks will only be initiated by district staff and will be paid in accordance with hourly rates outlined in WMA's proposal. They have proved to be extremely proficient, reliable, reasonable in cost, and accurate in performing their survey work for us in the past. Therefore, if there's concurrence from the board, staff will bring forth a resolution for your consideration and approval at the March 16th commission meeting, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Kevin, appreciate it. Any questions or comments? Thank you, we'll see you next week.
Thank you.
Our final item on the regular agenda, R6, is a recommendation to authorize execution of a funding agreement by and between the Forest Preserve District of DuPage County and Urban Rivers for mussel propagation. And we have Scott Meister here presenting.
President Hebriard, Board of Commissioners, good morning. My name is Scott Meister and I am the Manager of Natural Resources. And I'm here today to ask the board to enter into a formal partnership with Urban Rivers. Urban Rivers is a nonprofit organization based in Chicago with a mission to transform city rivers into urban sanctuaries. They have formed partnerships with the city of Chicago, community groups, large corporations, and local businesses to help accomplish their goals. Urban Rivers' flagship project is called the Wild Mile, which will be a mile-long floating park located on the north branch of the Chicago River on the east side of Goose Island between Chicago Avenue and North Avenue. The goal of the Wild Mile is to create a new environment for habitat, recreation, and education. So you can see that the goals of Urban Rivers and the Wild Mile closely align with the mission of the district. The completed Wild Mile will incorporate constructed floating wetlands, wooded shorelines, public walkways, and kayak docks along the North Branch. Urban Rivers' vision is for the Wild Mile to function as a public park, an open-air museum, a botanic garden, kayaker destination, classroom for the community, and to provide habitat for native wildlife. Urban Rivers began installing these floating wetlands in 2017. And by the end of this year, they will have installed about 12,000 square feet of wetlands in the Wild Mile. So now they're looking to improve on the ecosystems by incorporating freshwater mussels into the wetlands to improve water quality and to help further restoration of the ecosystem. So knowing that the district's Urban Stream Research Center has successfully propagated mussels and that we're one of maybe a dozen propagation facilities in the country, Urban Rivers approached us and asked us if we'd be willing to propagate mussels for them to introduce into the Chicago River. We felt this project was a good opportunity to become a community partner, promote healthy watersheds, and also provide another opportunity for our staff to learn and grow. If the funding agreement is executed, the district would receive $12,500 from Urban Rivers to rear giant floaters, a species of mussel historically found in the Chicago River. If Urban Rivers continues to be successful in securing grant money, the agreement allows for our partnership to continue for the next few years. Staff recommends entering into this funding agreement, and if the board concurs, we'll bring forth a resolution at next week's commission meeting. Be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you so much, Scott. This is an awesome partnership. Commissioner Tyson Dunn?
I just want to say how exciting I am about this. I love all the great work done over there, and just to have this opportunity, I think is fantastic for the team. So thank you so much for bringing this forward.
Sure thing, we're excited too.
Thank you.
Commissioner O'Meara?
I moved and I couldn't find me. and we've got the capabilities and the space and everything that this would require.
Yes. We've currently at the Urban Stream Research Center, we're at full capacity right now. Staff has propagated, we've got about, six cohorts. In the months of November, December, January of this past year, we initiated five new propagations, including Urban Rivers mussels, as well as mussels for our own release here in DuPage County. So we're at about capacity right now. I think there's nearly 27 juvenile mussels that we're currently rearing at the Urban Stream Research Center.
And when you say at capacity, you mean that we are making a lot of mussels, not at capacity, we couldn't take on this contract.
Correct. Okay. Correct. Yeah.
Thank you. Commissioner Painter?
Thank you.
And we're sure by introducing these into the Chicago River that there's no chance of them becoming invasive in any way. We're quite confident.
Yes, these are giant floaters. This is a species that's native to northeastern Illinois. It's a species that has historically been found on the north branch of the Chicago River. So it's not an invasive mussel like the zebra mussels that you've heard about.
Okay, thanks.
Question.
Go ahead, Al.
We're just doing the giant floaters. We're not introducing the Meister mussels, correct?
Not yet.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
Thanks. Further discussion or questions on this item? Great. Well, I can sense a lot of excitement. I think it's a fun partnership and looking forward to seeing this one next week. Thanks, Scott.
Thank you.
Very good.
And we do have one informational agenda item today. SL1 is management update for the Eastern Prairie Fringed Orchid. And we have Scott Cobalt presenting.
Let's start right now. Good morning, President Hebriard, members of the board, Director Stevenson. Tony, if you could start the presentation, that would be great. I wanted to thank you this morning for giving me the opportunity to talk to you about the ecology and management of the Eastern Prairie Fringed Orchid in DuPage County Forest Preserve. So we'll go over some of the things that the district is doing in this cooperative effort to recover this species with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. If I could, next slide, please. This is the Eastern Prairie Fringed Orchid, Platanthera leucophaea. And although this plant has white flowers, it's still a stunning orchid to see out in the field. And it's a real joy to see these plants. You can see from the photo on the left, where the plant gets, you know, part of its common name, the fact that these the lower petal that's three-parted, you can see the fringes on there. Like I said, a very intricate orchid. And it's always interesting to talk to folks because most people don't realize that we have wild orchids here in Illinois. They tend to think of orchids as being things that grow in the tropics, and yet they grow in our in woodlands, prairies, wetlands throughout the state of Illinois. Okay, the next slide, please. The habitat for this orchid is usually undisturbed areas such as wet prairie sedge meadow. So again, kind of going into its common name. So it's usually somewhat finicky about where it grows. So usually fairly undisturbed types of habitats. Back to the next slide, please. Unfortunately, we've lost a lot of this habitat throughout DuPage County and throughout the state of Illinois. A lot of it was lost to conversion of prairie lands for agriculture, drainage of these lands, again, for agricultural commercial development. And then you can see on the photo on the left, just the direct change of the habitat to commercial and residential development. Now, in 1872, Henry Babcock and his Flora of the Chicago and Vicinity noted that this was a species of moist prairies and that it was common in the area. 50 years later, Herman Papoon and his annotated Flora of the Chicago area wrote that although it was found in wet prairies and it was a characteristic plant of moist prairies west of Chicago, it was becoming increasingly rare. If I go to the next slide, please. So what you can see on the left here is the current and the former distribution of this plant in the United States throughout its entire range. And there's a number of states you can see that are kind of a very light tan. These are areas where the plant occurred historically. And the states and one Canadian province that are in that light green, those are the states and provinces that the plants, you know, currently resides in. And then over on the left-hand, on the right-hand side, you can see the former distribution within the state of Illinois. So in looking back to the map on the right, you can see, even though this plant occurs in a number of states, those little black dots, those are where the extant populations currently are. So you can see some states have only just a few populations on it. But one thing I did want to bring to your attention is that cluster of dots up in northeastern Illinois, which is basically the Chicago region. So really what you have here is, again, as President Hebride was talking about earlier today, formations of things like forest preserve districts, other protected lands in the Chicago region have really provided a vital habitat for this species. And that's why this is really one of the strongholds of this plant in northeastern Illinois here, whereas other areas of the state, virtually everything was converted and drained for agriculture. If I get the next slide, please. So because of this precipitous drop in numbers, in 1989, the Fish and Wildlife Service designated this a federally threatened species, and it's been on the state endangered list for over 40 years. But in 1999, they came up with a recovery plan that the Forest Preserve District is working as a cooperative partner with. And the tenets of this recovery plan are to protect the habitat of this plant, not only protect it, but then to manage it through things like prescribed fire, controlling invasive species, doing an annual census on the plant, trying to increase the size and the genetic diversity of existing populations through cross-pollinating between populations and moving seed between populations, and also continuing research to identify and evaluate the effectiveness of these recovery plans. If I get the next slide, please. So one of the things that we do at the Forest Preserve District is collect data, demographic data on the plants as part of that annual census on all of the locations that we have the plants at. So that involves things like, you know, locating, counting the number of flowering and non-flowering plants, doing demographics on each individual plant, like how many flowers there are, what's the height of the plant, if there's been any browse activity by insects or deer or things like that. Get to the next slide, please. And also looking at seed production. So usually earlier in the year, we're monitoring flowering plants. Then we come back to look at the plants and see, you know, how well they've progressed and how well they've produced seed. So what we're really looking at is how many of these seed pods are on the plants. And what we're really looking for are these plump pods. Like you can see in the center photo, the pod with the little red piece of wire on it. That was a pod that was hand pollinated. As you can see, it's nice and plump and hopefully has a lot of viable seed in it. So these are also some of the demographics that we record. If I get the next slide, please. Also, one of the things, some of the other things we're doing with this, we cage the plants, as you can see on the left. They're very palatable to deer. So we usually have to cage them to protect them so that they can flower and produce viable seed. In the center, you can see each plant is given a tag number so we can track individuals from year to year. Then over on the right, which was brought up a little earlier, we do use GIS to record the locations of each plant and populations within the Forest Preserve District also. Next slide, please. Now just a little bit on the pollination of this plant, because I'll go into a little more detail on the hand pollination that we do with this particular species. But natural pollination of this plant occurs with nocturnal hawk moths. So it has a very specific pollinator, kind of an interesting symbiotic relationship between the two. So you can see in the center top photo, these hawk moths usually have a very long proboscis or tongue, for lack of a better word, that they use to pollinate the flowers. So you can see on the center lower photo, the pollinia or the pollen sacs that are stuck to the proboscis of these moths. So as they move from flower to flower, they're picking up these pollen sacs, and then as they're going to the next one, they're putting them back on there. And in the lower photo on the right-hand side, you can see one of the pollinia or pollen sacs on the edge of a toothpick. So this is what's going on naturally. So in trying to help this plant along, we're going to try and mimic this. So if I can get the next slide, please. So with hand pollination, basically we're kind of doing the same thing. We're taking toothpicks, removing these pollen sacs or pollinia from one plant and putting it onto another plant. Now, they're self-incompatible, so you always want to make sure you're moving pollen from one plant to another within a population. We also move pollen between populations also. If I can get the next slide, please. So you can see just a few more pictures here of hand pollination. So it's kind of a delicate maneuver here. You can see on the right-hand side, you have a number of pollinia or pollen sacs at the end of toothpicks, which we're using to cross-pollinate plants. So as I mentioned, we not only cross-pollinate between our populations and within our populations, but we also receive pollen from U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service from other populations that we also use to introduce to our populations to, again, increase that genetic diversity and fitness of the plant. Next slide, please. So just some real close-ups here. You can see over on the right-hand side, kind of in the center of the flower, you can see those yellowish objects in the center of the flower there. Those are the pollinia. And then in between there, you can see a little whitish, somewhat triangular object. That's the, right there. That's the receptacle, the stigmatic surface. So that's where we want to put the pollen. So you can see in the photo on the right-hand side, the pollinia are very sticky. So they stick to the ends of the toothpicks, just like they stick to the proboscis on the moss. So we want to place that right in the center between those two pollen sacs on the receptacle for the best pollination. Next slide, please. So you can see, this is just something that's very new that's come from Fish and Wildlife Service. Previously, we didn't want to pollinate more than half the population and only a third of the flowers on each individual plant. But the thought now is that we should do more to increase seed production and, again, hopefully increase the productivity of this plant. Now, on the left, you can see kind of what you typically see when you just pollinate a few flowers. You can see particularly that one at the top, like one or two plump pods on an individual plant once they've gone to seed. What they're trying to strive for now is like the plant on the right, which has numerous plump pods on there that's hopefully going to provide a lot more seed production. And again, hopefully provide more offspring then for these plants. If I can get the next slide, please. Also, one of the things we do is seed dispersal. So oftentimes Fish and Wildlife will give us seed that they've collected from larger populations in the region, and we take and disperse that onto the sites where we have the plants. So you can see some of the pictures here of some of the various methods we've used over the years, like tying some of the seed pods to objects like stakes or stems of plants, or hanging them from some of the grasses, stringing them up almost like popcorn with a needle and thread, and tying them to various plants in that, trying to kind of mimic some of the natural seed dispersal. And this is evolving. For instance, like this year, what Fish and Wildlife staff recommended, which is simply to take the seed and just scrape a little area and get it in contact with the soil, which we did. So like everything else, as we learn as we go along with this, and we're seeing what works and what doesn't. If I can get the next slide, please. So as I mentioned earlier, I mean, not only are we, protecting the sites and monitoring the populations, we also have to manage the sites. And on the left, you can see one of the biggest ways we can do that is with prescribed fire. Now, these plants usually bloom more profusely in years of high rainfall and after prescribed burn. So unfortunately, we can't do anything about the amount of rainfall we get during the course of a year, but we can control if areas get burned. So this usually is a very good management tool for areas that we have this plant. Also in the center, you can see we do herbicide treatments on things like cattails, other herbaceous noxious plants like reed canary grass, purple loosestrife. And then on the right, you can see controlling woody growth, whether that be invasive things like buckthorn, or in some cases, even some of the native species like sandbar willow that we're trying to reduce their numbers in there. If I can get the next slide, please. So this is like looking at an area kind of before and after we've done some of the management in it. So you can see kind of opening it up, reducing cattails, reducing sandbar willows in this site to get back to that sedge meadow a type of habitat that is much more conducive for this species. So these are kind of what you call surgical strikes with these plants. It's very, very targeted, very selective, usually on individual invasive species. If I can get the next slide, please. Some of the things we've, the more innovative things we've been working on fairly recently, kind of on the research aspect, is inoculating some of the areas with mycorrhizal fungi. Now, these plants have a symbiotic relationship with mycorrhizal fungi, fungi down below the ground surface that, you know, live on the roots of the plant, and they're getting some carbon from the plant, and they're providing the plant with nutrients. So Dr. Larry Zettler had actually isolated some of these fungi, Serrata rhiza, and from a research permit he had with the Forest Preserve District, he isolated these from taking a small cutting from a plant in one of our populations and was able to culture this mycorrhizal fungi. So you can see over on the left, he had them in medium. And then what we did was just in the center, just make a solution of this fungi, kind of make a little slurry in that that we could inoculate certain areas with. If I get the next slide, please. So what we did was lay out some transects in areas where the plant occurs, and we just made some small holes, tag them, also GPS them. If I can get the next slide, please. And then what was done, you can see on the left, is taking some of that solution, putting that into the soil, so inoculating that with this fungi, and then taking, you can see on the right, orchid seeds that were provided by Fish and Wildlife, and then planting them in these areas that have been inoculated with the mycorrhizal fungi. I get the next slide, please. We're kind of still in the earliest stages of these. It takes these plants a number of years to grow from a seed to a flowering plant, but knowing exactly where they were, we have seen some progress so far. This was a small seedling at one of the sites that had been planted that showed up a few years after we had actually done the inoculation. I can get the next slide, please. And what this is, what I'm just showing you here is just the latest data we have from the state of Illinois on the number of blooming orchid plants per year. So this is looking at the 29-year census of this plant starting in 1991 all the way through just last year in 2000. So you can see we've had some ups and downs with this. A lot of that is based on drought years. We tend to get lower numbers of flowering plants after we've had drought. But one thing you'll notice in 2020 is we had our best year ever with over 2,200 flowering plants throughout the state. And a lot of this is the work of dedicated staff. And I do want to definitely give a shout out to all the volunteers that work with these plants, not only with our agency, but with others, doing some of the management, controlling some of the plants on these sites. The invasive plants, as to speak, and also doing helping with the census work. I mean, this is another one of these programs that we really couldn't get done without all the dedicated volunteers that work, like I said, not only with our agency, but with other agencies throughout the region and with Fish and Wildlife. If I can get the next slide, please. So just in conclusion, we're working on this this plant. Its numbers have been improving. Recently, just in December of 2020, Fish and Wildlife Service decided to keep its status as federally threatened. Although it has improved, it hasn't improved enough to the point that it can be delisted yet or get any change of status, but it's definitely on the right track with the interest in the plant and the management of the habitat. And like I said, I always like to close with some pretty pictures. As one presenter at Wild Things conference took place a couple weeks ago said, orchids always make us feel better. So it's always nice to close with a picture like that. So I just want to thank you for your time this morning, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that you would have on the program that we've been working on.
Thank you so much, Scott, for all the work and acknowledging all the volunteers and other efforts. Commissioner Painter?
Yeah, it's very interesting and pretty cool looking flower. How prolific are the night moths that do this pollination?
Unfortunately, not too prolific. I do see some plants that do get pollinated, ones that I haven't hand pollinated myself. but it's throughout the region, it's not really enough to maintain the species. Unfortunately, the plants are, they're in small areas, they're isolated from one another. So it's much more difficult for the pollinators to get to these plants and do the cross-pollination work that's really needed. So that's why Fish and Wildlife Service decided to step up and, you know, do the hand pollination, because otherwise we wouldn't be getting the seed production we would, and the population probably would not be improving at the rate it is.
Okay, well, maybe is there anything that we can do to help the little moth?
Probably like a lot of the things we have been doing, like trying to improve the habitat, protect areas, just like we try to do things for monarchs. I mean, protecting areas, managing them, getting them in the best shape they are, having a lot of the other plants around for them is probably the best thing we can do.
Are there moth caterpillars around that we might see? Or are they that rare that we probably wouldn't see something?
Well, you'd probably see some. I mean, some of them are related to like some of the tomato hornworms, for instance, some of the sphinx moths. I mean, they're similar to these plants, like tomato tobacco hornworms. Some of the hawk moths are related to those. So you might see some like that, but they're not encountered, as frequently, as some of the others. And again, being moths, they're usually nocturnal. So there are usually a lot of species we really don't see as much like we do butterflies, because they're out, after dark usually.
Okay.
Thank you. Commissioner Garris?
I think my questions were along the same line as Commissioner Painter. But I was just wondering about the hawk moth and maybe all moths, really. If you put out a light on your front porch, you don't see moths circulating around anymore, which suggests a massive collapse of nighttime pollinators in the population. And hawk moths might be part of that. And I don't know. Maybe we need to reinvigorate our efforts to reach out to the public about what we need to protect the night pollinators, protect the entire ecosystem. And I know that some of our forest preserves are right next to highly lighted places. That might be part of it, with light pollution. Another part might be use of pesticides. I just wondered if there's a big picture issue here that we can engage the public with.
Definitely all of those points, are important. Just like we talk about, like bees and other pollinators that folks see out during the day, these nighttime pollinators are just as important. So again, trying to protect the habitat, like you said, trying to limit the use of pesticides or anything we can to like help, other insect populations or other pollinators along would be helpful to these species also. And the public always appreciates like that relationship between the plants, just the plants and animals, and one of the basic tenets of ecology that everything is connected to everything else. So, I mean, what they're doing, in their yard might seem small and inconsequential, but it, as you said, it does affect the big picture of what we're trying to do as a society and better these areas and protect these plants and animals.
Yeah, because I was just thinking also how we spray for mosquitoes at night, and it's often said that, this is targeting just mosquitoes and nothing else. But I think a lot of people who try to protect the monarchs are skeptical of that message. So I guess there's complexity here.
Yeah, yes, there is.
Yes.
Thank you. Commissioner O'Meara?
Thank you.
Well, Commissioner Painter brought up great points with the moth, but I was looking at the other end, the viability of the pollen when you take it. Does it require refrigeration, and how long does the pollen last? And then secondly, the seed viability. When you get those seeds, how long can you keep those?
Generally with the pollen, usually when we get that from Fish and Wildlife or when I collect it myself, we usually keep it in a cooler, and it's that day or the next day we're trying to pollinate those plants. So we don't leave it sitting around very long. It's usually something fairly immediately. Seed viability, that can last in the soil for a number of years. They're very small seeds. Yeah, they're very tiny, and they don't have like a huge amount of like stored food in them, like, some seeds from some other plants would be like. So usually we try and the same thing with that. I try and get them into the ground, as soon as Fish and Wildlife, gives them to us from some of the exchanges we've had, or if I'm moving any seed from any of our populations, that's usually, very quickly I try and do that. Again, because the quicker you do that, the better the viability of the seed's going to be.
Okay, thanks.
You're welcome.
Commissioner Tyson Dunn?
Hi, thanks so much again. This is a great presentation. It's one of those bucket list plants I've been trying to photograph and have yet to see in the wild. How many would we have in our forest preserves with the census you've collected?
If I look at last year, maybe if I'm just looking at flowering plants, probably 40 to 50, maybe with all the populations we have. What the Fish and Wildlife Service is trying to do, one of their goals is to have 22 populations that have what they refer to as high viability. And this year last year we got to 12, which doesn't sound like a lot, but it's actually very good because we've never been that high before. The populations we have in DuPage, we have two that are moderate and one that's considered low. So, and that's what the bulk of populations are, you know, within the Chicago region here. It's just that, again, many times these plants are in very small, isolated areas, and there's not that many of them. But just like I was showing you the information on statewide, the records, we also did very well last year with the number of flowering and non-flowering plants that were observed. It was the most I'd seen, since we've been doing the census on there. So again, some of it's tied to rainfall because we keep having the wettest May on record every year, but a lot of it too is attributable to the management that the district is doing on those sites.
And would you pollinate all the plants that you find each year, or would you?
Generally what we try and do, as you can see, we've been a little more conservative. Now Fish and Wildlife is saying be a little bit more aggressive and pollinate more flowers. So this year I anticipate trying to hand pollinate more flowers than what I've done in the past. Because before it was like no more than half the population, no more than a third of the flowers on one individual plant. So like I said, we were just like anything else. We started off very conservative with this, but I think we're seeing is like, well, we can do a little bit more and increase seed production, which hopefully is going to ensure more plants and help the survival of the species then.
Great. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome.
Commissioner Painter?
Back to the little moth. What's so difficult is to try to educate us and the public to differentiate between good moths and bad moths, because we had a horrible gypsy moth problem here. So that gave moths a really bad name. So, when we had the gypsy moth, we wanted to squash them all. So you have to figure out which are the good ones and which are the bad ones. I can't even imagine how you educate everybody to know the difference.
Yeah, almost the majority of our moths are native species, and they're very valuable. I know, but you're absolutely right. Moths got a bad name. I remember as a kid growing up, they got in your closets and ate your clothes and hats and that sort of thing. You put mothballs in there for that sort of reason. But I think people are becoming more environmentally aware now. So a lot of it would probably be educational to explain the importance. Again, they're a very important pollinator. One, unfortunately, that most people don't see because they're out at night when we're really not out. So we don't see them unless we're near a light or something. But yeah, that would be, one of the big things. And these are large moths too. They're not like some of the small ones we see, like maybe flitting around a light in that. Sometimes they're even referred to as hummingbird moths because they're almost the size of and remind you somewhat of hummingbird flitting around. So they're very large and noticeable if you do see them. Unfortunately, we just don't see them that often unless you'd be out in certain spots, after
dark. Are they out during the daytime at all? Because now that you're mentioning, I have seen something like that. Like when I was in Colorado, we were seeing.
Yeah, occasionally you will see them, out during the day, but primarily they're going to be foraging and, doing their pollination work at night.
Because I want to think we were at a restaurant watching these things. They looked like hummingbirds. We were trying to figure it out, and somebody said they were moths. So I don't know if there's other moths that look like that as well or not, but I may have seen one.
Yeah, there's some, even like the tomato hornworm that, we see the larvae on our tomato plants in our gardens. They metamorphosize into like one of the sphinx moths. And so they're large and, fly and have that kind of hummingbird type of flight to them too.
Thank you, Commissioner Al Murphy.
Yes, I do have a question. And I'm not looking for specific locations, but do you feel that we need additional natural areas in forest to help with this plant throughout the district?
You enforcement, you do?
More areas designated as natural areas. It's a state program.
Oh, the nature preserves. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
It never hurts. I'll say that. But I think usually, like I said, these plants are going to be in, you know, very, you know, pristine, you know, types of habitats. And I think, you know, most of the locations that we have, the plants are protected adequately, you know, at this point. But we always keep looking. I mean, you never know where they might show up, but we always keep our eyes open.
Very good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Scott, thank you so much for the steady hands and the delicate touch and all the volunteers and staff that work with you. We really appreciate it. So keep up the good work.
Thank you. Much appreciated.
And that concludes our agenda today.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to adjourn. Roll call, please.
Don't we have closed session, Mr. President?
Oh, I apologize. Thank you. I will entertain a motion for closed session.
Motion for a closed session.
Second.
I think we have to have some specific language due to state law. So we're going to have Mr. Unger to help us with that.
I'd like to make a motion pursuant to Section 2C1 of the Open Meetings Act. I move that the board go into closed session for the purpose of discussing personnel matters.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to go into closed session. Roll call, please.
O'Meara.
Aye.
Painter.
Aye.
Tyson Dunn.
Aye.
Garris.
Aye.
Hebriard.
Aye.
Al Murphy.
Aye.
Marsha Murphy.
Oh, Marsha, you're on mute. Okay.
I need your voice.
Aye.
There we go.
All ayes, Mr. President.
Well, thank you, Madam Secretary, for saving us today. We appreciate it. We are now in adjournment of the open session for this moment and going to closed session once the media has